Well, let us continue with the next topic. What is it that makes an agent moral in doing an act? And again, we're distinguishing this from what makes the action a morally good or morally evil act. This is a question to which there have been a variety of answers given, and some of them I think are not in fact correct, but they're at least worth looking at before I share with you what I think is the proper approach. The first one of those answers that I think is not the way to answer this is to say, well, the agent acted morally if the consequences when he or she acted were positive. Now, I think that there are a lot of folk in our society today who actually have this viewpoint. They might not state it in the form of an ethical question and say it exactly the way we are, but I think that's what a lot of people think, that really there aren't moral rules that cover a lot of things, and so you just have to kind of try to figure out what's going to have the best results, and you do whatever feels right, and once you've done that, if things turn out positively, then you should feel good about it. If they don't, then you shouldn't feel all that good about it. So typically folk who take this approach are looking entirely for anticipated results. They're not so much looking at whether there's a moral rule that governs the situation or that doesn't. But let me share with you a couple of examples of why consequences are not, in fact, what makes the agent moral in doing an act. Let's think about that fellow who tried to save people from that plane wreck in the Potomac. And if the question is, well, did he act morally? Well, if consequences are the determining factor in deciding whether the agent acted morally or not, wouldn't we have to say that each time he went back and was successful, well, then he acted morally on those occasions. But on the occasion when he went back and was unsuccessful and the person he was trying to free drowned and he drowned, well, it turned out badly, so he acted immorally. Now, I would guess that hearing that kind of analysis, you'd say, well, that was outrageous to think that someone would think that what made this man moral is what the results were. I mean, we're not even talking about heroism, supererogation. We're just saying this guy was acting morally when he was successful and immorally when he failed. Let me give you another example of why consequences cannot be what makes the agent, the person, moral or immoral in doing an act. Suppose it turns out that somebody walks into a bank with the intent to rob it, and they hold up the bank, they get away with an awful lot of money, and let's say maybe the money is never recovered, the person is not apprehended, but as a result of that incident, the bank decides that, you know, we've got to make this a much safer environment than it has been. So what they do is they install surveillance cameras throughout the bank, and they decide that there's going to be a couple of armed security guards every moment that the bank is open. And the net result of that is that everybody who banks at that bank, their money is way safer than it ever was before. Now, if consequences are what makes an agent moral in doing an act, since things turned out this way, we'd have to say that the bank robber acted morally, because the result of his robbing the bank is that everybody's money winds up being safer. Well, hopefully you find that outrageous. I do too. But if you do, I'm sure you do, because you realize that the results cannot be the determining factor in whether an agent has acted morally or immorally. Well, let's try another one. You have acted morally if you do an action which is a morally good action to do. Now, on the surface of it, this probably sounds pretty good, doesn't it? I mean, we're at least not saying that someone who does something immoral is actually himself a moral hero because things turned out well. No, we're saying in this case, you actually have to do an action which is morally obligatory. So this sounds better, but I would suggest to you that even this answer is not quite as good as it might seem. And I think I can explain very quickly, and you will agree, once you realize the explanation I'm going to give. As you read through the pages of Scripture, let's think just of the New Testament at this point, it becomes very, very clear as you're reading through the Gospels that there was a group of people in Jesus' day who were quite famous for finding what the moral law required and any other law required and conforming their behavior precisely to that law. Who are we talking about? Pharisees, yes. Now, did the fact that they did all kinds of morally good acts to do that were actually required under, many of them, under Mosaic law, does that mean that they acted as moral paragons, moral examples? Well, Jesus didn't think so. Jesus referred to them as whited sepulchres. Very, very vivid imagery. On the outside, everything is nicely painted. It's clean. It's beautiful. It looks great. There's external conformity to whatever the rules say, but inside, it's not white. It's not pretty. It's death. And it's not that in the Old Testament, all that was required was find out the rules and do them, but it's in the New Testament that something more is required. No, 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 no. That's true even in the Old Testament. What did God say to Israel about all their sacrifices? He was not impressed. They had all these sacrifices. They did all kinds of things that the law required, and God was totally unimpressed because he said, your heart is far from me. So, and ultimately, that's the problem with the Pharisees too, right? They were concerned to feather their own nest, so to speak, to enhance their own reputation. And it's interesting that they made a public display of obeying the law so that everyone could see how wonderful they were. But Jesus was not fooled. God was not fooled. So evidently doing a morally good act is not enough to guarantee that you're acting morally. Well, so what might be an appropriate answer? I would suggest that three things, and we're saying three things taken together, not any of them done to the exclusion of the other, but all three of these things would help you to define acting morally when you act. First of all, the act that you do has to be done freely. You know, it's possible to get children to do everything you want by threatening them appropriately, or by offering them rewards and making it real clear that if they don't do the act that gets the reward, they're going to be really, really sorry. Well, yes, you can get the right kind of external behavior, but they weren't doing it freely. They were forced in one way or another. In order to be morally accountable, either good or bad, you have to act freely. So, if I'm going to be considered moral in doing an act, I've got to do it freely. If someone forces me to do the right thing, well, that doesn't mean I'm a moral hero. That just means I take orders well, or threats or whatever. But a second factor, we somewhat hinted at it when we were talking about God's reaction to the people of Israel in the Old Testament and Jesus' assessment of the Pharisees. And you have to do freely what you do with the right motivation. Well, what is the right motivation? Well, Scripture doesn't give us a lengthy discourse on this. It doesn't really go into even a short or brief exposition of it. But I think that we can tell that what Jesus was concerned about with the Pharisees is that they were doing the right thing to further their agenda and to raise them in the estimation of other people in their day. And also the Pharisees probably thought that if I obey God's law as he has laid it out in Scripture, well, then even God should praise me. And, you know, because when I do what he wants me to do, shouldn't he give me credit? So it wasn't just that they wanted to enhance their reputation with other people. They wanted to enhance their reputation with God. And what could be better than God thinking that he owed it to you to tell you how terrific you are? Well, obviously, that wasn't the right motivation. Well, what is the right motivation as Scripture portrays it? You do the right thing because it's the right thing to do. You have a love for the moral law and the moral lawgiver in particular. You do duty for the sake of duty, not for something else. Now, that seems to be the basic perspective that you have in Scripture. But moving beyond Scripture, the person who in secular philosophical ethics has probably said the most, at least the most influential, is Immanuel Kant. And in one of his works on ethics that's entitled The Foundations of the Metaphysics of Morals, he takes up this issue of how do you know whether you're acting morally? And Kant distinguishes two different types of rules. On the one hand, there are what he calls hypothetical imperatives. A hypothetical imperative says, if you want such and such a result, then you should do X, Y, or Z. A categorical imperative, in contrast to a hypothetical one, says, here's what you are to do, period. Thou shalt not kill. That's an example of a categorical imperative. An imperative that says, if you want to increase your overall sales, lower your prices below all your competitors. Now, that's a hypothetical imperative. Kant would say hypothetical imperatives are imperatives of prudence or wisdom. They are not imperatives of morality. What does he mean? Well, if you want to increase your volume of sales over all of your competitors, lower your prices below all of the competition. That's good, sound advice on how to get ahead as a businessman. That's practical advice. But that doesn't mean that you're acting morally. You've figured out how to manipulate the system to enhance your sales. That doesn't mean you're a moral hero. That means you've got a certain amount of practical wisdom. Okay, so then I should be working in accord with categorical imperatives then. Imperatives that just state my duty, yes. In a section of this work, Kant talks about possible motivations that a person might have. Now, he imagines, or we could imagine, that let's say someone, maybe they don't know how to swim, or maybe they do, but somehow or other they fall into a swimming pool, and they start to react. They start to swim or to move their arms and their legs and do things to get out of that pool to save their life. Now, Kant would say in a case like that, probably the person in this case is doing these activities as a basic impulse of self-preservation. Most of us wouldn't think, well, God has said it's not right to take innocent life, and it is good to preserve innocent life. And for the sake of the moral law and of the moral lawgiver, I will try to save myself. I don't think most of us would have any of that go through our mind if we fell into a swimming pool. Rather, it's just a basic reaction that we try to preserve ourselves. So if somebody tries to save themselves when they fall into a swimming pool, don't assume that they did the right thing for the right reason, right motivation. The businessman who lowers his prices so that he can sell more than any of his competitors, well, he's acted prudentially. He's not acted morally. Well, then, what is the right motivation for doing a given deed? Kant says the right motivation for doing an act is that it is your duty, and out of your love for duty and for the duty giver, we would add, that's the reason that you do it. Do you do it because of the way things will turn out? No, we looked at that as one possible thing that makes someone moral. Do it for the sake of the consequence. No, you do it because it's the right thing to do. And whether you say the right thing to do is determined by reason, as Kant did, or whether you say the right thing to do is determined by prescription from Scripture, as I think most, if not all of us, would say, we would say that what makes me morally good in doing an action is that I did it freely and I did it with the right motivation. But one more thing. You do a morally good act to do. Now, you may be thinking, wait a minute, I thought a little bit ago you told us that wasn't it. Well, we said, not that alone, that's the Pharisees, right? But all three of these things have to be true for you or for me to say that we have acted morally. Look at it this way. Suppose someone says, no one's forcing me to go and shoot whoever, so I'm going to do this freely, and I think that I ought to do this because I believe that duty requires it, and I am so in love with duty that I just have to do whatever duty requires. Would we say to him, well, you're a moral hero? No. We would say, well, it's good that you've done whatever you're going to do freely, and it's good that you do it for the sake of duty itself, but you're wrong about what your duty is. Your duty is not to take innocent life. Your duty is to preserve innocent life. So, in order for someone to be acting morally, he needs to define what duty is, do it freely, and do it for the right motivation. Now, that's at a theoretical level. But class, I would just say, I think this gives us some tests that we can use in our own life to evaluate the things that we do on any given day, the choices that we make. Have I acted morally today? Well, here are some tests. Did I do what I did because I was afraid of getting punished if I didn't? Well, then I probably didn't do it freely. Did I do what I did because people expect me to obey certain rules and my reputation would be ruined if I disobeyed? That's not the right motivation. Did I do what I did because it's the right thing to do and I believe God has required it of us and I want to obey God for God's sake, regardless of what the consequences are? And, oh yes, I have checked Scripture and I'm sure that this is something that I'm required to do. Now, I would guess that for most of us, we're going to do most of the things in a given day that we do freely. And hopefully most of the things we will do are morally good acts. I think where the rub comes in, and I can't tell you that this has happened in your case, you're the only one before the Lord who can make that assessment, and I have to make that assessment for myself. I have to look at what I've done and ask, now, why did I do that? Did I do this because it's the right thing to do and I don't care what people think about me, even if it's bad, even if they're surprised, etc., etc.? I think a lot of us probably do the right thing freely, but not always with the right motivation. And that's a reminder of how sinful we can be. And how we can, I think at times, convince ourselves that we're very, very moral people, very godly people, because like the Pharisees, our life conforms to the law. But the Pharisees had the wrong motivation, and sometimes I think we may as well. Now, if someone says, wait a minute, brother. Are you suggesting that if I don't have the right motivation, I might just as well do anything I want? Yes, there was an opportunity on a certain occasion that I could have committed adultery, but I'm married, and so I didn't. But I followed the rule, for the wrong motivation. So should I have gone ahead and committed adultery anyway because, you know, I didn't really do the right thing for the right reason, so I should have been able to do anything. Well, not at all. Remember that our actions have implications, if I can put it this way, in two directions. What we do affects our relationship with God, but what we do also has implications for other people. And it may be that if I resist the sin, I may be no more morally good than if I engage in the sin. From God's perspective, I may in both instances be guilty of sinning because I have the wrong motivation. But it sure makes a whole lot of difference to the people who I know, the people in my life, my family in particular, as to whether I fall to this sin or whether I don't. So if you come to the conclusion that you did the right thing but with the wrong motivation, don't say to yourself, well, next time I'll do the wrong thing, because if I don't have the right motivation, I can't act morally. So it would have been just as good for me to sin as opposed to not sin because my motivation was wrong. No, 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 don't think that way. Minimize evil as much as you can. Okay, let me pause and ask if you have any questions or comments about this at this point. Yes, in the back.
If we're in the garden and Adam and Eve are there and Eve picks up the fruit to eat and Adam stops her and says, Eve, don't do it because God has told us that we're going to die if we take a bite. They don't eat. Did they sin?
The question is, if Adam and Eve are in the garden and Eve picks up a piece of fruit and she's ready to eat it and to offer it perhaps to Adam, and he says to her, no, 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 Eve, don't do this because if you do it, surely we're going to die. And as a result of hearing what Adam has to say, she decides not to eat it. The question is, did they commit a sin anyway? Well, presumably, the act was done freely in the sense that Adam didn't rip the fruit out of her hand or, you know, hold her arm behind his back, her back, so that she couldn't do it. And yes, he did make an argument. Sometimes it's hard to know whether an argument that's made comes off as a threat or a reasonable consideration. And here, if I may just say on the side, a lot here depends on your notion of free will. My notion of free will is such that even though the act can be causally determined, it can be free as long as the person does what they would like to do. That tells you I'm a compatibilist. Now, having said that, I don't take it that Adam making that kind of comment would necessarily have to make Eve refuse to take the apple unfreely. Motivation. Well, I mean, none of us was there. My guess is that since at that point neither of them had a sin nature, they didn't have all that baggage that you and I bring to each situation. So it could well be possible that Adam and Eve, on that occasion, without all the negative impact of the sin nature upon them, did have the right motivation. And we know that in the imagined scenario, if Eve had refused to eat the fruit, she would have done a morally obligatory action, so it would have been morally good. So I would say most likely, no, neither Adam or Eve would have sinned if they had resisted in the scenario outlined. But I say that more from the perspective of understanding what little any of us can understand about human nature before the fall, as opposed to human nature after the fall. If we're talking about they've already fallen into sin, and there's another moral dilemma that they're facing, or moral choice, I should say, and they do the right thing, well, then knowing what we know about our own motivation, sometimes when we do the right thing, we might have more of a question about it. Okay, good, yes.
The example about the spies from Israel and Rab, can we say that in that case it was morally right to lie and to protect life for the spies?
Okay, good question. The question, what about the case where there were spies who went in to spy out the land, and in the process of this, is in the Old Testament, they wind up telling a lie. Here, what I think I need to say is a couple of things. First of all, the question raises the issue of moral conflicts. What do you do when two ethical rules conflict? We're going to talk about that later. But second, and perhaps even more to the point, remember, we're not talking now about whether the action is morally right or wrong, but whether the agent is morally right or wrong. So, in a case like this, we would have to first of all see how we're going to handle ethical conflicts and figure out what their duty would be in that situation. Then we have to ask, did they do it freely? Did they have the right motivation? And given our reasoning in terms of how to handle moral conflicts, was this the morally good act to do? Then we could answer this question. Good question, though. You're thinking in the right direction. Yeah.
I'm wondering about the second criteria, the right motivation. Mm-hmm. It seems very difficult to do practically. And when I think of, for example, 1 Corinthians 4, Paul says, "But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact, I don't even judge myself. For I'm not aware of anything against myself, but I'm not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me." So he accepts, like, he could be judged for wrong motivations, but it seems like practically he says, but it's really hard to judge myself, because I'm not even aware of my sin. So, like, could you just clarify how you would know that you have the right motivation? Because it seems hard practically.
Okay, the question is about the second item in the list, and it is specifically in a real case, how can you actually know what your motivation is? There was a quoting of 1 Corinthians 4, 3 through 4, where Paul talks about not judging other people, the Lord judging him, and, you know, he doesn't always know, and we as well don't always know. I think a couple of things I would say. Whether or not it is possible to decide in specific cases whether someone acted freely or whether they acted with the right motivation, and if there's a conflict of duties, it may be hard to figure out what the morally good act to do is in a given case. But no matter how hard it is to decide those things in any given case, that doesn't nullify these things as the answer. But the point that you're making is, in fact, I think, a good reminder to us, first of all, that we do need to check our motivation, but that we need to be honest with ourselves and honest before the Lord. And I think in all truth, we need to ask the Lord to reveal to us if our motivation was wrong. And I think if we know we have a certain set of things we've got to do in this upcoming day, and that's going to involve various things that are moral decisions, I think we should ask the Lord not only to help us do the right thing, but do it for the right reason. But then to realize, given what we know from psychology, that it may be very, very difficult for us in specific instances to know exactly what our motivation was. And in some cases, we may know what our motivation is, and it may be mixed. It may be that there are some good things we intend, but also some evil things. Or not evil, but at least not morally good, but positive in terms of the consequences for me. All of this says to me, it's a reminder of how sinful we are, even though we are redeemed. And that we should recognize that and ask for cleansing and pardon from sin and ask the Holy Spirit to help us change our motivation and change our activity. But I think the best you can do is to pray for the right motivation. If, you know, be as honest as you can, make adjustments. Where you see that there's a problem, ask the Lord to reveal to you if you still haven't gotten it right. But we're not going to be infallible in this. But if I may just underscore how important this point of motivation is, let me do it this way. Isn't this ultimately one of the things that was at stake in the book of Job? I mean, what was Satan's accusation? God says to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? He is righteous. He's this, that, and the other. There's no one like him. And what's Satan's reply? Well, sure. You only heap blessings in his lap. Who wouldn't serve someone who dumped all kinds of positive things in their lap? But Job isn't serving you and obeying you because you're worthy of obedience and you're worthy of praise. Job's doing this because it pays to do so. So what's the book of Job about? Well, many different things, but one of them is that God wants to demonstrate to Job and anyone else who cares to think about it, that there are people who actually love and serve God not because it pays to do so, but because he's worthy. And that's really what we're talking about here. Doing the right thing that God commands us for the right reason. And in this particular dimension of our existence, we may have some trouble in actually being honest enough to evaluate accurately whether our motivation is right, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't at least consider this and think through what our motivation is and make adjustments when the Lord reveals that we're doing the right thing but for the wrong reason. Okay, yes, one more.
I was thinking about Wyatt's question, but from the perspective of an unbeliever. How should we understand item two in light of somebody who, in one sense, will never be able to have a pure right motivation to act?
Great question. The question is, all of these things make sense and are achievable to a certain extent if you're a believer. But is there a different set of things for a non-believer? Because it seems like if there's not, if these are the same standards for a non-believer, no non-believer could ever qualify in terms of the second item as doing something moral. I would say that, first of all, I know that Kant, as he's talking about some of these things, is surely not making a distinction between believers and unbelievers. He wants this idea of motivation to apply to everyone. And of course, with his worldview, he thinks that people could know what their motivation is and they could have the right motivation. As I look at Scripture, I have to agree with the direction I see you going, that no, someone who is a non-believer, I don't think could ever have the right motivation, which is what? To obey God's will and His word for the sake of the moral lawgiver, because it's our duty, because it's the right thing to do, because God demands it, and we love our duty and we love the duty giver. Now, here again, you get into a theological question that we won't go into other than for me just to mention it, but there's the whole question of whether even a believer could have the right motivation without God enabling them and doing it through them. Now, depending on whether you are more Arminian or Calvinistic in your theology, you might have a different answer to that. I'm sufficiently Calvinistic in my theology that I think without divine enablement, even a believer cannot have the right motivation. So surely I would think that no non-believer has as their motivation that they have come up with on their own, doing the right thing for the right motivation, ultimately to honor and to please God. I don't think that that's possible. And hence, that shows all the more how lost people are, because even when they're doing things which even we as believers would say are very noble to do, they still aren't getting moral merit with God, the one person who matters. Now, obviously, we don't want to say, oh, well, then let society go to the dogs and, you know, let's let people do whatever they want to do, because without Christ, they can't possibly please God anyway. Yeah, but you and I, before the rapture, still have to live in the society that that produces. And it surely is preferable that people will do the right thing, even if they do it with the wrong motivation, than that they do the wrong thing because they can't do the right thing with the right motivation. Right? I mean, it does make a difference horizontally. It doesn't make any difference. They don't get merit with God. They don't score points with Him. But it sure makes a difference to the rest of us. Okay, one more and then we do need to move on. Yes?
Yeah, as far as the right motivation goes, would you see a distinction in between doing something as far as earthly rewards that God gives and then eternal rewards that God gives?
Good question. The question is, in terms of right motivation, is there a distinction between doing something for earthly material goods as opposed to eternal spiritual rewards? Well, here is where there arises an issue that I think we could probably debate for the rest of the week and perhaps not convince one another. And it's not an unimportant reason or issue either. And it's the whole question of what our attitude should be towards eternal rewards. Now, Scripture definitely teaches that there are rewards for believers for service. And we are told to run the race so as to win a prize. And I think as a result, there are a lot of Christians who adopt this mindset and say, and they go at it almost as though they're, well, they give you the impression that They want to get the biggest prize down the road. To what end? Well, so they can show it off to everyone, or just what? It's not entirely clear. I mean, some folk, when they talk about our rewards for service, say, yes, we're going to get those crowns and jewels in the crown, but not so that we go around through eternity wearing them and flaunting them. We're going to cast them in homage at the feet of Christ, because it's only because of him and through his power that we were able to do any of these things. I mean, that's incredible grace. God doesn't owe us a reward unless he obligates himself to it, but in the nature of the thing, he doesn't have to give us any reward. He's obligated us, obligated himself to give us a reward. Then he empowers us to do the deeds that merit the rewards. Well, it sounds to me like the one who should get the rewards is the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and yet he turns around and on Judgment Day is going to give those rewards to us. Well, wouldn't it be sort of the height of excessive pride to stand there at the judgment seat of Christ, receive those rewards, and think, well, boy, what are the occasions from here on in when I can wear these things so everyone can see how great I was? I mean, no, if you realize that God didn't have to give any reward, it was in grace that he decided to do that, and then he enabled me to do the things that merit the reward, so he should really get the reward, not me, but he gives it to me. I mean, how can you at that point, I think when we stand in his presence, we'll be much more aware spiritually and morally of the truth than we are right now, and it probably sounds outrageous to us even right now to think of flaunting our rewards when we realize how it is that we're going to get them. Okay, that enough on that part of it. What am I saying? What I'm saying is, yes, Scripture does say run the race so as to win a prize. So that should be somewhere on our radar screen. But not with the view that I've got to win the prize so that everyone will see how wonderful I am and I can flaunt it. It seems to me that the question of motivation gets very, very hard, because I should be motivated, since Scripture says run the race so as to win a prize. I should be motivated by that. But what I'm saying is not everything that could go with that motivation should go. I should run the race so as to win a prize, and I surely don't want to be disqualified. But if it's because that would be embarrassing, well, no, it's because that would be disobedient to my Lord and Master. But to want to win the prize so that once I get it, I can flaunt it and everyone will look up to me, I don't think that's the intent of the doctrine of rewards at that point. So right motivation here could be very, very hard to figure out in a specific thing where we're serving the Lord. Why really am I doing this? I guess from a practical standpoint, at least in my case, much of the time, I think, here I haven't analyzed every circumstance, but much of the time, I try to put that issue in the back of my mind or hardly think of it at all and think instead, what does God want me to do and what is there that I can do for God? The results of that down the road, God's going to take care of. Yeah, occasionally I think about, like, to win the prize, but that seems secondary to me. And maybe I'm wrong on that, but that begins to worry me about this right motivation. I don't want to wind up inadvertently being a Pharisee. You know, I want to do the right thing so that everyone will acknowledge that I do the right thing and I will be a great moral hero. No, I want to serve the Lord because he's worthy of being served. And when you think about how much he served me and you, there's no way I could possibly repay that. But I sure like to see if I couldn't do something that contributes to what he's doing in the world, if possible. Okay, well, let us move on, if we may. I realize that all of these things we could spend several days on. But we have limited time, and so I think it would be good for us to move on. Well, the next topic I want to address is to look at specific ethical theories that are available as you and I, as Christians, are trying to figure out what our ethical theory ought to be, what our way of deciding right and wrong should be. And as mentioned here, it's not always easy to figure out what a given author's scheme is for classifying ethical theories. In fact, I remember a number of years ago when I first began to teach ethics and had to write the lectures for this part of the course, I had read several different books, and I thought, you know, this makes no sense at all, because it appears that each author has his own system of classifying the ethical theory. And I wasn't sure exactly what to do with it. For example, the following texts have their own ways of classifying ethical theories, and there's occasionally a little bit of overlap, but not much. This is a book, Norman Geisler's Ethics, Alternatives, and Issues. Probably many of you are familiar with this. It's been around for a long time. He has a section on ethical theory, and he mentions a number of different ethical theories. A second book, this is written by William Frankena, a secular ethicist, and he not only talks about different ethical questions, but different theories, but he doesn't seem to talk about the same theories or use the same categories as Geisler does. And if that weren't confusing enough, there's Edward Long's A Survey of Christian Ethics. You might have thought, okay, well, that should look a bit more like what Geisler has done, but it doesn't. It really seems to go a different direction. So for a while, I found myself a bit confused until I came to the realization that we can actually make some progress on this topic when we realize that each category scheme of those three books in particular is constructed to answer a specific ethical question. And it's not the same ethical question in each case. And the category scheme is constructed in accord with the question that's being asked. For example, in Long's book, the focus of his discussion and also of his category scheme is answering the question, where do ethical norms or rules come from? How do we get them? Frankena, in contrast, is more concerned about asking what makes an action, not the agent, but the action, morally good or morally evil. And Geisler is asking a different kind of question. His concern is, how many moral rules are they, and how do they relate to one another? Do they conflict? Do they not conflict? If they conflict, how do you resolve the conflict? Those are the kind of issues that Geisler is concerned about. Well, okay, if the basis of a category scheme is the question you want to ask and answer, I think all three of these questions are valuable questions. So let's take them one at a time. And let's begin by looking at ethical theories that focus, at least they're organized so as to focus on the source of ethical norms. And as Edward Long shows, in the history of Western thought, at least the last 2,000 years, there have been three basic answers to the question, where do we get our ethical rules from? And what I'm going to do is share each of those answers with you and give you an example or two of theories that went in this direction. The first answer to where do ethical rules come from is that the source of ethical norms and answers to ethical issues is reason. Well, okay. Undoubtedly, the most famous, the most well-known, and widely held Christian ethical system that is reason-based is known as natural law ethics. Now, typically people who are Roman Catholic, especially if they're more traditional Roman Catholics, are people who hold natural law ethics. But it's not just Roman Catholics who have been natural law ethicists. There's a lot of Protestants who appeal to this approach. Now, what does this approach actually say? Well, let me read to you just briefly a definition that one writer gave of natural law ethics. And don't try to take this down, just listen to it and then we'll summarize a few things. Natural law ethics is conceived of as principles of human conduct that are discoverable by reason from the basic inclinations of human nature and that are absolute, immutable, and of universal validity for all times and places. So, what's the basic idea of natural law ethics? Incidentally, you may be wondering, well, who in the history of Christianity, what name can you associate with natural law ethics? Undoubtedly, the most famous natural law ethicist was Aquinas, St. Thomas Aquinas. And it is not surprising that he should have gone this direction because of his love for the ancient philosopher Aristotle. As you know, Aristotle's works had been lost for quite a while, and then they were found, and various Christian theologians tried to synthesize the philosophy of Aristotle with Christianity, none more so than St. Thomas Aquinas. Now, you may wonder, well, what does that have to do with Aristotle? Well, Aristotle talked about four different causes of anything. So let's say that the thing we're talking about is this screen. We could talk about the material cause. The material cause would tell us the kind of things out of which the screen was made. We could talk about the formal cause of a thing. yes, there is a certain type of matter that was used in constructing this screen, but before it was made into a screen, it didn't have this particular form. When the people who made this decided to make a screen, they got the material, they put it together and put a specific form on it, namely the form that this screen has. Aristotle also talks about the efficient cause of a thing. That refers sort of to the agency, the power, if you will, that gets something done. And then he talks about the final cause, which refers to the purpose for which something is made. So, the efficient cause would be the constructing of all of this together and would include the person who did that constructing. I don't know exactly what the material is out of which they make screens. Some of you would know that better than I. We see the form. The purpose of it is so that things could be projected onto it and seen. Now, the most important of those causes when it comes to natural law ethics is the final cause, the end or the purpose. And what natural law ethics says is that by simply opening your eyes and ears, perhaps your nose as well, and experiencing the world around you, seeing how things work, you can tell the purpose that things were made to accomplish. And when it comes, for example, to human beings, although you could talk about animals instead, but let's take human beings and let's talk about various parts of their physical body, their sexual organs. All of those are made to accomplish a purpose. And the purpose, according to a natural law ethicist, is to produce children. Now, if that's the purpose for which human sexuality was given, then natural law ethics says you should be able to understand by the light of pure reason alone, as you reflect on what you see in the world and how it works, you should be able to understand then that anything that inhibits something from accomplishing its purpose is morally wrong. Let me repeat. By looking at how things are in the world, how they work, what is the intended goal of a thing, you should not only see what it was intended to accomplish, but you should realize that anything that inhibits the ability of that thing to perform its function is morally wrong. Well, hence, a natural law ethicist would say that any form of birth control is immoral, other than using something perhaps like the rhythm method or abstinence. This also would mean that abortion is morally wrong because abortion makes it impossible for human sexual relations to complete the purpose for which they were created, the bearing of children. If this sounds familiar, it should. It's at the heart of Roman Catholic thinking. Natural law ethics. Now, remember the definition. It says these things are absolute and immutable. unless we should wake up some morning and everything works totally different than it did, it's hard to imagine what that would mean. But unless that should happen, it's unthinkable that the rules would change. So regardless of your culture, regardless of your time in history, by the light of pure reason as applied to what you see in the natural order, anyone and everyone should always know the rules of right and wrong. Okay, so that's natural law ethics. It's clearly based on reason. Now, interestingly, a lot of the rules that natural law ethicists would generate would look quite familiar to what you find in Scripture. But natural law ethics says we don't go to Scripture to get our rule. We look to reason. Well, a secular example of a reason-based system is Kantian ethics. We've already said a little bit about Immanuel Kant, but Kant believed that it was possible to determine moral duty on the basis of pure reason alone. And eventually, well, Kant had said, and we talked about this a little bit earlier, that hypothetical imperatives are imperatives, they're rules of prudence. They're not rules of morality. A categorical imperative, that's a rule of morality. It doesn't say, if you want X, then you should do Y. It just says, here's what you should do. Well, Kant said, most fundamentally, there is a rule that you should follow in all ethical reasoning. And that rule is to act in accord only with the rules which you could reasonably will to become a universal law. Act only in accord with the rules that you could reasonably will to become a moral, a universal law. Now, that statement I've just made, and it's not the only way that it could be stated, but that's known as the categorical imperative. Kant is well known for his categorical imperative, this one in particular. Now, how does that work? Well, let's take a particular activity. Suppose I decide that I would like to steal something from, well, it could be only one person, but it could be a number of people. Now, Kant says, the way to tell whether this act is morally right or wrong is to see if you could reasonably will that it should become a universal law. In this case, it would mean that stealing is morally right for everyone. But now, if stealing is morally right for everyone and everyone steals, society is going to collapse, right? I mean, private property is not going to mean anything. So you couldn't reasonably will that people should steal. Therefore, stealing is morally wrong. Same thing with murder. If everybody can commit murder, you're going to have genocide, right? Well, that would be unreasonable. Therefore, murder should be wrong, and so on and so forth. Gives you a little flavor of how this works. Now, Kant is not anti-scripture, and he wouldn't come up with rules that are widely divergent from what you'd find in scripture, but the basis of it is not from looking at scripture, but from reason and reason alone. So in Kantian thinking, whether you're a Christian, whether you're a Buddhist, a Hindu, or an atheist, you should be able to come up with the same moral rules that anyone else does, because it's not based on anyone's holy book, it's based on pure reason alone. Well, okay, so the first answer to where do moral rules come from is reason. And we've given you a couple of examples. Let me just take a question or two, and then let's take another break, this time maybe only for 10 minutes, and then we'll come back and finish up today. Yes?
Does this mean that his thinking is therefore that the majority is right?
Well, his thinking is that not just the majority, but everyone who is capable of reasoning at all, which is going to be most of us. I think, you know, Kant never addressed what this would mean to someone mentally impaired. But for those of us with our faculties functioning, he believes that we, in fact, will come to this conclusion. And Kant had a very positive attitude toward human nature. He thinks that people seeing what's reasonable to do will have the will to do it. You know, that's just one of the places that I think we would disagree with him. We have a much firmer belief in the sin nature and the implications of that than he did. So, I forgot to repeat the question at the outset. The question was, did Kant basically say that the majority rules? And my response was, well, no, that's not exactly what he's saying. He's saying that not just the majority, but everyone with the capacity to reason should be able to see whether something could be made into a universal law or not. And then he also had the belief, it's not part of his ethics, but he also had the belief that human nature could be trusted to do what reason dictated it ought to do. Yes?
Does that mean that a Kantian ethicist would generally fall in the category of people that blame world religions for the cause of having different views on ethics?
The question is, does this mean that someone committed to Kantian ethics would likely blame world religions as the cause of people having different ethical systems? Not really. At least, let's put it this way. Surely there are people who hold some form of Kantian ethics who do just that, but that wasn't what even remotely motivated Kant. Remember, he's living in the 1700s, I believe it is, and at that point, society is, European society is pretty openly Christian, whether they're majority are born again is another question, but Christianity is not seen as the culprit. And interestingly, when Kant gets to talking about the existence of God, he doesn't think there's a rational proof that works, but he does believe that you have to postulate the existence of God in order for moral governance of the universe to be ensured. So how much of a religious believer he was personally is a question that historians of philosophy, et cetera, would have to answer. But no, this is not something that requires our contemporary, what has oftentimes been referred to as the new atheism, where belief in any kind of God is painted not only as wrong, but as dangerous.